Thank you all very much for joining. For those of you that don't know me, my name's Charlie. I'm in the first year of the MBA. And thank you all for making time to join us today, and thank you to all those that are joining online as well. Our session here is called Impact at Scale, the role of investment in delivering sustainable development. And we have here Nick O'Donoghue as our first speaker, and we're very grateful to him for joining us and coming from London today. I'm going to hand over to Nick, who's going to say some words to the lectern in a second, but just a little bit of housekeeping how this is going to go. Nick is going to speak for about 15 or 20 minutes, and then we'll have time for Q&A, so please do take some notes and consider a question you might want to put to Nick. I will have one or two up my sleeve, but I really would like for you guys to put your questions to him, and that would be, I think, a lot more interesting for everyone. Well, one thing I would ask is that you do keep them brief so we can get through as many as possible. And for guests that are online, we also haven't forgotten about you. So if you'd like to ask a question, please do so in the chat. We have Guillaume, who's monitoring that for us here in the room, and we'll include you if you have a question to ask. In both cases, please give us your name and a little bit about yourself. Are you a student here? Where are you from? And so on. So Nick, your bio, and then I'll stop talking. So Nick is the chief exec of CDC Group. It has been so since 2017. He's also a member of the board. He was previously a senior advisor to the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, where he specialized in the use of blended finance models to support the work of the foundation. And prior to this role, he co-founded Big Society Capital with Sir Ronald Cohen and served as the chief exec there from 2011 to 2015. Previously, Nick worked at JP Morgan, latterly to head of global research. And he was telling us last night at the ESA Impact Fund event that he co-authored Impact Investments, an Emerging Asset Class, which was, I believe, the most read research the firm has ever published. Prior to JP Morgan, Nick spent 15 years at Goldman Sachs. He has an MBA from Wharton. We won't hold that against him. And he went to Trinity College before that. So, Nick, thank you very much for joining us, and I'll hand over to you.
Thanks, John. Thanks, Charlie, and good afternoon, everybody, and it's a real pleasure to be here. I wholeheartedly agree with Mark's opening comments that when it's amazing to think that this is the 19th version of doing well, because I can tell you that 19 years ago, this was not an area that people were in any way, whether the companies, investors, business schools, were focused on. So I think it's a real testament to this school and to its values that it's that it has sponsored this event and for so long. So I suppose I come with somewhat of a unique perspective on impact investing, because if you listen to Charlie's introduction, I have had the opportunity to work in a large institution, JP Morgan, as they began their journey into social finance and impact investment. I've had the opportunity to work in a startup, which was Big Society Capital, along with Sir Ronald Cohen, who was one of the real legends of the impact investment world. I've had the opportunity to work with the world's largest foundation, the Gates Foundation, as we explored, or they explored, the development of blended finance. And then laterally, I've had the opportunity for 5 years to lead the world's or the UK's development finance institution. So those are four very different sort of areas of impact investing, but I think it does give one a really good perspective and overview on how this whole industry and movement has developed. And I think I'd start by saying that if you were one of the people, as I was lucky enough to be, who 10 years ago was at the Rockefeller Foundation's event in their campus, that they have, beautiful campus that they have in Bellagio, where there were sort of 20 people sitting around the table talking about the idea that perhaps it was possible to combine purpose with investment, and thinking, what do we call this? And then deciding that we'll call it impact investment. That was 10 years ago. And if you look at what has happened since then, I think it's been the growth of impact investment has been really quite extraordinary. We, as Charlie said, at JP Morgan, our sort of post Bellagio contribution was to write a piece of research, which was the first time any major institution had looked at impact investment, even really used the words. At the time, we said we anticipated it could be anywhere from $400 billion to $1 trillion in terms of assets in 10 years. We were laughed at, and it was considered to be absolutely ludicrous that we would suggest that this movement or this idea could have this sort of could grow this quickly. But that indeed is what has happened. And if you look at the gin numbers today, the latest numbers talk about $750, $800 billion. And if you look at IFC, for example, and their measurement is well over $2 trillion. And that's an impact investment. And of course, at the same time, this has also dragged along a whole movement in ESG and sustainable investment, all of which have grown over the last decade, and all of which basically have at their core this idea that when you invest money, you should care about what the impact of that money is, not just the risk and return. And I think we were talking last night at this event about why this has happened over the last 10 years. And I think there's really two reasons. I think, like any great movement, timing is important. And in 2000, 2007, 2008, and many of you in this room will be barely old enough to remember this, but in 2007, 2008, we had the global financial crisis. And I think that really opened people's eyes, the public's eyes, society's eyes, to the importance of investment and to the fact that the decisions that you make around how you're going to allocate your capital make a difference to people's lives. That was quite a transformational sort of moment, really. And I think there was an ambition, and it didn't really come from the top, from the heads of the great investment management organizations, but much more from the bottom up, an ambition to really do better and to think more broadly about the consequences of the investment decisions we made. So that was one element, the sort of timing element. I think the other thing that obviously has been very important is that the two great challenges that our societies face today globally of gross inequality and of climate change. Those two challenges have not got any better over the last decade. In fact, if anything, they've got worse. And we have, during this period of time, we've had the launch of the Sustainable Development Goals. And the Sustainable Development Goals I think, focused also people's minds on the need for vast amounts of capital to address these goals, and if we're going to be successful in reaching them in 2030. And you know, we've probably all heard numbers of, particularly in developing markets, where we need probably $2.5 trillion a year of investment to achieve goals, if we're even to come close to achieving goals in 2030. Total overseas development aid today is about $150 billion, and it's not going higher. So this huge gap in money and in financing and in funding needs to come from investment. And that is the purpose, and that is the importance of impact investment. We can only achieve the sort of scale that we need to achieve in outcomes through investment and through participation and through growth of the private sector. And that's where all the impact investment community come in, and that's where development finance institutions come in, and that's where an organization like CDC comes in. At CDC, we're proud to say that we are the world's oldest development finance institution. We were founded in 1948, and when we were founded by a gentleman, our first chairman was a gentleman called Lord Reith, and those of you who are British may know Lord Reith is most famous for being the founder of the BBC. But when, in his role as chairman of CDC, he was asked what CDC was for, he said, CDC, the purpose of CDC is to do good without losing money. And that, I think, over the last 73 years, we've had our ups and downs and our various iterations and reincarnations, but that has been really the thread that has run through everything that we have done. And I think still today, that's a reasonably good sort of generalization of what the impact investment movement is all about. But today, CDC employs about 500 people. We have a balance sheet of about $10 billion. We invested last year $2.5 billion. We're focused only on two regions. One is Africa, and principally sub-Saharan Africa, and one is South Asia, so India and the neighboring countries. Every investment decision that we make is an impact investment decision, meaning we, at every, if you went to an investment committee meeting at CDC, what you would hear is a rigorous discussion of the financial outlook for a company, in the same way that any typical traditional private equity firm would look at. But at the same time and alongside that, a very rigorous discussion of what difference making this investment will make to people's lives in the countries in which we're investing. And we think we start with the view that countries, and it's, I think, a fact that no country has been able to develop and really alleviate poverty without growing without growing a robust private sector. And private sectors, we know, can only grow with capital. Most of the countries that we invest in don't have domestic savings pools, or they don't have their own capital markets. And that a capital that's provided to help those companies grow so they can create jobs and so they can help pay taxes and have employees pay taxes, the capital that's provided must be provided in a way that respects the rights of every stakeholder and respects the rights of the community in which those companies and those investments are being made. So that is basically at the heart of everything that CDC does. And I think not just at the time of investment, but also subsequently. So it's not just about putting the money to work and walking away. Most of what we do is in private capital markets, and particularly for those people investing in private markets, it gives you a degree of influence, particularly if you own equity, and 75% of what CDC does is equity. It gives you an influence over those companies. So when you invest in a company because you believe it has the capacity to expand affordable goods and services, for example, to vulnerable, poorer communities, then you have to stay with that company, use whatever influence you can get on board through board seats or whatever to make sure it stays true to that purpose. So today, if you looked at CDC's portfolio, you would see us with investments in everything from fiber networks across companies building fiber networks across Africa, hydropower in Nepal, solar power in Egypt, a new second mobile network in Ethiopia, venture capital, supporting venture capital and SMEs both directly and indirectly through funds. We're the largest investor in private equity funds, for example, in Africa. And this capital is critically, this impact capital is critically needed in these countries. And just to give you a couple of statistics today, if you looked at the installed private capital in OECD countries, you'd find that it comes out about $110,000 per person. If you looked at installed private capital in Africa, it's only $7,000. If you look at taxes paid, the average taxes paid per person in sub-Saharan Africa is $390. In the OECD, it's $14,000. And it's taxes that pay to build social infrastructure and health and education and help economies grow. So impact investment through organizations like CDC, through development finance communities, but also through the wider impact investment community is desperately needed. Now, there is a difference between saying and maintaining you're an impact investor and being a mainstream investor. And I just wanted to talk briefly about four of the key differences. And I think anybody who claims that they want to be in this field, you need to think about these and be comfortable that these are consistent with how you want to invest your money. The first one is that impact capital is patient capital. And when I came to CDC 5 years ago, our oldest investment we'd made in 1964, and I don't think when we made that investment in 1964, we actually intended that we would actually hold it for as long as we've actually ended up holding it for. But it does give you the sense of what, of how patient you have to be sometimes. And again, particularly, I'm talking a lot of the comments I make are quite focused on, obviously, on emerging markets because that's what our remit is for. But particularly in those markets, you have to be prepared to be a long-term patient investor. I don't think, and this is probably a separate discussion, I don't think that the Western fund model, particularly the private capital fund model, the GP, LP type structure is particularly well suited actually for impact investment, particularly in Africa. But you have to be very patient for many of these things to actually work out. I think the second thing you have to be as an impact investor you have to try to be additional. And by that I mean, you have to take risk in places that other people are not necessarily willing to take risk. And so for us, I mean, in CDC, and for me personally, when I worked at JP Morgan and Goldman Sachs before that, I mean, my business life was conducted in the UK, in the US, in Japan, and developed Europe. My business life today at CDC is conducted in places like the DRC and Pakistan and Nepal and even Zimbabwe. these are really difficult places to invest in. But I think if we really want to create impact, and if we really want to help develop people's lives, those are the sort of difficult places where we as impact investors should be going. And I also think the same is true on the sector basis. I would argue today in the world of climate finance that traditional solar farms and wind farms and funding those assets in the developed world, certainly, and even in the developing world, these are things that are actually becoming quite mainstream. And if you want to be an impact investor, you need to look at the other things, the more difficult things, the newer things. We need to be looking, and at CDC, we're looking at things like battery storage or EV infrastructure or EV manufacturing or solar manufacturing or green hydrogen or green water desalination. Those are the areas that are really the difficult areas, and those are the areas that require impact investors willing to take higher levels of risk. Thirdly, I think you need to be really clear about defining your pathway to impact. And that means, and some of you will be familiar with the Impact Management Project, which is, I think, a very good framework and structure for thinking about this. But you need to be very clear. When you make an investment, you say it's an impact investment. When I look at pictures and people show me, you know, they do their pitches, whenever, the first question I ask myself is not actually whether the business is going to work, although that is really important, because you don't back sustainable businesses, you don't create any impact. But I ask myself, who's going to benefit? Who are the beneficiaries that we're really thinking about? How much are they going to benefit? What real difference is it going to make to somebody's life? So I think having an idea of that pathway is critical. And then finally, I'd say for those of us who are lucky enough to work in large scale institutions, which CDC certainly is in the context of impact investment, we need to help mobilize other capital. We need to be a first mover in markets. We need to be embracing areas like blended finance and using our capital to leverage in or crowd in other forms of capital. We need to help provide credibility and ideally some confidence to investing, as I said, in some of the most difficult markets. We need to be prepared to support funds, first-time funds. As anybody who's in the funds business will know, it's very difficult to raise money for first-time funds. We need to be prepared. We need to be prepared to do that. So look, that's a lot to do and a lot to take in, but I think you're all here because you believe in the idea of impact investment. I think you're all right to think that it presents enormous opportunities for people of your generation, this generation of MBA students. As I look in the future, you're going to see, in the world of climate is going to be far and away the most significant movement of capital in your lifetime, without any question. And you know, I was in India recently. They need $400 billion of investment in their renewable platforms by 2030, just to live up to the commitments they made at COP. And that's just the beginning. That doesn't count all the investment they're going to have to make in panel manufacturing and EV and EV infrastructure and all those other things that are part of a transition to a green economy in a country like India. So that is a massive opportunity. A large amount of that funding will need to be impact investment. So I think there's still an enormous amount to do on measurement, and it's the thing we talk a lot about in the impact investment movement, but there is a huge amount. We're making some progress towards harmonization of standards and measurements and metrics, but we still have a long way to go, and it took 100 years to develop generally accepted accounting principles. So we're 10 years probably into this idea of trying to develop measurement techniques, but there is a lot more to do. There's a lot more to do in blended finance. It has enormous potential, but it's also technically, as I learned at the Gates Foundation and before, it's technically very different, and transactions are actually difficult to bring to market. So there is a huge opportunity going forward. I think there's been a massive shift over the last 10 years. I mean, this has been really, for those of us, again, who sat around that table 10 years ago in Bellagio, I think if you told us we would be where we are now, we would have said that was completely fanciful. So it's been a huge, so almost a shock to see how quickly this world has developed. But the reality, too, is we're not denting the problems. We're not the issues I talked about before of global inequality, climate change, these issues are not getting better. They're getting worse, and they're getting harder, and they're getting more urgent. It's therefore vitally important that your generation and your generation of MBAs takes a leadership role in helping to develop this field even more. And that's it's a great pleasure to be here. And as I say, very encouraging to see how many people are interested in this field. And I wish you lots of luck. Thank you.